Never before have the skeletal remains of any animal created such excitement and controversy as when the Ethiopian remains of Lucy were moved to a museum in Houston, Texas for public display. Hello, my name is Eric Garloff. Lucy's appearance in Houston was scheduled to last from August 31, 2007 to April 20, 2008. Although Lucy's skeleton is missing approximately 60% of its bones, the 40% which remains is expected to draw large numbers of viewers. The artifacts are scheduled to return to Ethiopia in 2013. Her six-year tour outside of Ethiopia is not only calculated to raise money, but it's also calculated to tell her story. But is the story being told by the exhibition the true story? And by what means or measuring stick do you use to determine if the story is true or false? Do you blindly believe the evolutionary story simply because it's printed in school textbooks? Do you merely accept it as a fact because that's what you've been taught? Or do you hold to the position that since it's done in the name of science, that it must be true? Do you think the proponents of evolution have ever tried to make the evidence lean in favor of evolution by other than honest means? What you're about to see are the chapters of Lucy's story that won't be on exhibit. And once you do, you'll have the real answers to many of these questions. You'll also have the knowledge and understanding to use your God-given wisdom in knowing who Lucy really is. But first, let's take a moment to discuss what knowledge, wisdom, and understanding are, how they differ from each other, and how they can be applied to the information which the evolutionary theory is built upon. First, let's define the term knowledge. Knowledge could be defined as the mere accumulation of unrelated and unorganized facts, without the ability to apply these facts to practical life. Understanding, on the other hand, indicates the ability to evaluate and organize facts, which in turn provides the foundation for wisdom. Once the knowledge base of facts is established and the understanding of those facts takes place by properly studying and examining the facts, then wisdom comes into the picture as the ability to make honest and practical use of those facts, which is what we're going to do in this program. In the Bible's book of James, chapter 1 and verse 5, we find this statement which says, "If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God who gives generously to all, without finding fault, and it will be given to him." So you see, friends, if you have knowledge and understanding, all you need to do for wisdom is to ask God for it. So I'm asking you to keep an open mind as we begin examining the bones that have been unearthed and used to support the evolutionary theory. Examine these facts you're about to see. Seek an understanding of the truth they hold and ask God to give you wisdom in forming your conclusion. Let's take a brief look at what science has learned regarding the fossil remains of six discoveries, which all held high hopes for being the so-called missing link in man's evolution. As we begin, I'd like to make this statement. If the evolution of humans from an ape-like ancestor is true, there should be two proof evidences, or two things which prove this theory. The first is the fossil record. The second is a mechanism for change, or in other words, tangible evidence that would suggest that it's possible to evolve from one type of species into another. We're going to begin by examining the fossil records of six discoveries from 1856 to 1974. Each of these fossils were used to support the theory of evolution. Once we have looked at these fossil records, we will then look at the mechanism for change. The six discoveries we're going to look at are, first, Neanderthal man, second, Java man, third, Piltdown man, fourth, Nebraska man, fifth, Ramapithecus, and finally sixth, which is Lucy. Much hope was placed on each of these discoveries as the missing link in the line of human evolution. But since each of these discoveries were made and proclaimed to the world, they have all been discredited and proven not to be the missing link. Since the first five are pretty much common knowledge, we'll only briefly mention them. However, since Lucy is still being heavily promoted as the missing link, we will spend a little more time examining her. Beginning with Neanderthal man, here is the original artist sketch or drawing made of Neanderthal man. Please notice the unique blend of human feet, upright body, hairy ape-like appearance, and ape-like face. Neanderthal man was first found near Dusseldorf, Germany in 1856. He was drawn to look ape-like, but this rendering was wrong. scientists have found that Neanderthal man used jewelry, played musical instruments, made paintings, was capable of speech, and buried their dead. Most anthropologists recognize burial as a very human and very religious act. But the strongest evidence that Neanderthals were fully human and of our species is that at four sites, Neanderthals and modern humans were buried together. These findings all point to the Neanderthals as being fully human. Also, the analysis of Neanderthal DNA failed to demonstrate any significant difference in DNA from modern humans. So, what conclusions can we come to about the Neanderthal man? We can conclude they were an isolated population of people living in a cold, harsh climate. They were artisans in that they used jewelry, played musical instruments, and made paintings. Their skeletons show that they had a protruding brow ridge, a stocky build, and short extremities. They buried their dead, and most importantly, they were 100% human. Now let's look at the facts concerning the bones of Java Man. In 1891, Eugene Dubois found an ape-like skull cap and a human-like thigh bone 45 feet apart in East Java, Indonesia. The claim was that these bones were 500,000 years old. Rudolf Virchow, who is regarded as the father of modern pathology, stated at the time of the discovery concerning the skull cap, he said, "In my opinion, this creature was an animal, a giant gibbon, in fact." Then he says, "The thigh bone has not the slightest connection with the skull." Human fossils were also found in Java, dating about the same age as the Java Man bones. Since 1950, anthropologists and textbooks have been calling Java Man Homo erectus, which is upright man, instead of its original name, Pithecanthropus, which means ape man. The conclusion about Java Man is that human and ape-like fossils were found together and used to promote an intermediate transition. The thigh bone and the skull cap do not belong to the same creature. Now we turn our attention to Piltdown Man. The facts about the bones of Piltdown Man contain an interesting story. Piltdown Man's story is similar to Java Man in that bones from two different sources were used to promote this find. However, Piltdown Man was taken a step farther. Piltdown Man was an intentional deception. That's right. The bone fragments from two sources were fabricated or modified to fit into one skull and intentionally promoted as the missing link. These bone fragments were found between 1908 and 1912 in Piltdown, England. One fragment was that of a human skull, while the other was that of an ape-like jawbone. The claim was made that these bones were a 500,000-year-old missing link in the evolution of man. The New York Times ran an article titled "Darwin Theory Proved True." Piltdown Man was featured in textbooks and encyclopedias. Then, in 1953, approximately four decades after the discovery of these bone fragments, scientists studied the bones and uncovered Piltdown Man for the hoax that he was. They dated the bones to be only 600 years old. The conclusion of Piltdown Man is that men deliberately combined the bones from different creatures in a deliberate hoax to fool the scientific community and mislead the world. Now we'll consider the facts about the bones of Nebraska Man. This one is going to be very quick because all that was found in Nebraska Man was a tooth. The fossil evidence for this tooth was discovered in 1922. It was used to support evolution in the 1925 Scopes trial. The claim was made that this tooth was a 1-million-year-old intermediate link. The truth turned out to be quite different, however. The tooth was not the tooth of a man or of an ape, but rather the tooth belonged to a pig. That's right, it belonged to a pig, but until it was uncovered, it was used to support evolution. Are you beginning to see a pattern here? Are you beginning to see what's happening? Fossils are discovered, then great claims are made to support evolution. Papers are written, pictures are taken, artists' sketches are drawn, books are published, and everyone is told that evolution is true. Then, after a passage of time, when the evidence is fully examined, it's discovered that the great claims had no merit whatsoever. Yet evolutionists still cling to their theory, which today they say is a fact, but they still have no legitimate evidence to prove or support their claims. Anyway, let's move on to our next set of facts about the bones of Ramapithecus. The lower jaw of what we know today as Ramapithecus was found in 1930. yet from this jaw, artistic license was exercised, and you can see here what they drew from only a jaw. You will notice that this ape-like creature is drawn as a biped, or an upright walker, slightly hunched over, as if he was half man and half ape. Time magazine reported in its November 7, 1977 issue the following: Ramapithecus is ideally structured to be an ancestor of hominids. If he isn't, we don't have anything else that is. Hominid means belonging to the family of humans. In other words, in 1977, Time magazine was saying that if Ramapithecus is not part of the human family, there is nothing else which has been discovered to fill the role of being the missing link. Ramapithecus was claimed to be a 14-million-year-old intermediate link between ape-like creatures and humans. The truth, however, is that a baboon living in Ethiopia was discovered to have the same dental structure and similar morphological features as found on Ramapithecus's jaw, which, you'll remember, is the only thing that they found. The end result was that Ramapithecus was dropped from the human line. The Columbia Encyclopedia, 6th edition, 2001, states, "A complete jaw discovered in 1976 was clearly non-hominid, and Ramapithecus is now regarded to be an ancestor of the orangutan." The conclusion about Ramapithecus is that artistic license was used in drawing Ramapithecus to look like an upright walker, to look as if he was evolving. But Ramapithecus is the ancestor of the orangutan, not a member of the human family. Perhaps our most interesting study on the facts about the bones will be with Lucy. Lucy is an Australopithecine. In Latin, Australis means of the south. The Greek word pithecus means ape. The claim is made that the Australopithecines are a group of extinct hominids closely related to humans. Most of them are around 4 to 4.5 feet tall. Lucy was discovered in 1974, and approximately 60% of her bones were missing. They claim that she's 3.5 million years old and walked upright. You can see here what they found and what they drew. In this artist's imaginative conception, what do you notice about the Australopithecine which he drew? Do you see the contemplative expression, his human-like hands, the suggestion of his usage of tools, an upright stance? In National Geographic's March 1996 issue, page 109, artist John Gertsch stated, "I wanted to get a human soul into this ape-like face," to indicate something about where he was headed. In other words, artistic license was once again used to make the Australopithecines appear to be evolving. In reality, Lucy had no similarity in appearance to humans. She had long arms identical to chimpanzees. The jaw and upper leg bone are similar to a chimpanzee. Her brain was 65% smaller than the human brain. The Australopithecines had large back muscles for tree dwelling, hands similar to a pygmy chimp, and their feet were long and curved for hanging onto tree limbs. Scientists studied and examined three areas to determine if Lucy walked upright. They were, 1, the rib cage; 2nd was the pelvis; and 3rd were the leg and foot bones. Apes' ribs are conical-shaped, while human ribs are barrel-shaped. PhDs Brad Harab and Bert Thompson stated, "In Lucy's case, her ribs are conical, like those found in apes." Moving on to the pelvis, you can see here that there is a huge difference between the chimp and human pelvises. The shape of the pelvis can be used to determine if a creature is capable of bipedal motion, or walking upright. In the American Journal of Physical Anthropology, J. Stern and R. Sussman stated, "The fact that the anterior portion of the iliac blade faces laterally in humans, but not in chimpanzees, is obvious. The marked resemblance of Lucy to the chimpanzee is equally obvious. It suggests to us that the mechanism of lateral pelvic balance during bipedalism was closer to that in apes than in humans." In other words, Lucy's pelvis is wrong for bipedal motion or for walking upright because it's very ape-like. This brings us to the legs and feet of Lucy. Notice how she is portrayed in the St. Louis Zoo as having altogether human-looking feet and legs. PhD David Catchpole stated, "A serious reconstruction error is to wrongly align Lucy's big toe along the smaller toes like a human foot." Anatomist Dr. Charles Oxnard shows that the big toe actually sticks out, as in chimpanzees. Can you tell which footprint belongs to the human and which belongs to the ape? Professor Betsy Schumann, evolutionist expert, admits that the statue's feet probably are not accurate. But when asked whether the statue should be changed, she says absolutely not. In other words, it's okay to promote deception if it strengthens the theory. PhD Stuart Burgess stated that there are so many unique features required for bipedal motion that it's impossible for a quadruped to gradually evolve into a biped. Let's mention just 10 of these unique features and characteristics. Fine balance, flat face, upright skull, straight back, fully extendable hip joints, angled femur bones, fully extendable knee joints, long legs, arched feet, and the location or position of the large toe. This brings us to our conclusion about Lucy. The facts about Lucy's bones all point to Lucy as being an extinct relative of the chimpanzee, as Lucy was not a biped, but rather a tree-dwelling knuckle walker. Now we're going to look at the problem that the evolutionist had when it came time to dating Lucy's remains. We first start with fossil number 1470, which was found in 1972. It's a skull that is modern in appearance, having a brain capacity of about 800 cc's. The interesting thing about this find is that the skull was buried beneath a layer of rock that was dated to be 2.6 million years old. Thus, the skull, which was beneath the 2.6 million year old rock, had to be older, so it was dated at 2.9 million years old. Now, here's where it gets interesting. Lucy was also found buried beneath a layer of rock dated to be 2.6 million years old. And not only that, but the layer of rock that was under her was dated to be 3 million years old. This caused a big problem for the evolutionists, because how could it be that a modern-type skull was found in the same layer that Lucy was found in? In order for Lucy to be the missing link, she would have to be older than the modern skull. So how did they solve this problem? They threw out the potassium-argon dating system and used fossil pig sequences to redate Lucy to 3.5 million years old. So then, here's one question that everyone should be asking ourselves. If the evolutionists don't trust potassium-argon dating, then why should we, the public, be asked to trust them? Let's quickly summarize the facts about the bones of our six candidates. The bones of Java Man are the remains of two different creatures. Piltdown Man was an intentional hoax. Nebraska Man was a pig tooth. Ramapithecus was an ape drawn with human characteristics. Neanderthal Man was a man drawn with ape-like characteristics. Lucy is not a member of the human family because she's an extinct type of chimpanzee. Do you recall the earlier statement I made, which said if the evolution of humans from an ape-like ancestor is true, there should be two proof evidences? The first is the fossil record, which we have now seen does not support the claims of evolution. The other proof evidence is a mechanism for change. Let's look at this now. Is there a mechanism for change that could cause a Lucy-like creature to evolve into a human? The theory is that some type of beneficial mutation occurs. Then natural selection selects this mutation over any existing genes or other detrimental mutations that code for this function. Then, finally, the mutation is inherited by the offspring. Now, the key to remember about this process is that in order for this to take place, it must add new genetic information. So, one of our questions is, can natural selection cause one kind of species to become a new kind? The answer is no, it cannot. Natural selection only works with existing information. Natural selection does just what the name implies. It selects. It does not create new information. Natural selection is the ability to adapt to the environment, or shall we say it's the survival of the fittest. Variation within a species is not evolution. For example, compare these different variations: the Watutsi, the Pygmy, dwarfism, the Eskimo Inuits, and basketball players. Here is a picture of Billy Barty. He's 3'9" tall. Next to him is a picture of Shaquille O'Neal, who's 7'1" tall. This is an example of genetic variation, not evolution. Let's talk about mutations as a mechanism for change. Please follow along with me on this flowchart, beginning in the upper left-hand corner. If a mutation is detrimental and it leads to or causes disease, then evolution does not take place. If a mutation is neutral and produces no change, then evolution does not take place. If a mutation is beneficial, Then you must ask if it adds information to the genetic code. If it does add information, then you must ask if it causes a change in morphology, or a change in the form and structure of the organism as a whole. If that answer is yes, then evolution is possible. If that answer is no, then evolution does not take place. If the beneficial mutation does not add information, then once again, evolution does not take place. In 1989, four PhDs, three from the field of biology and one from the field of zoology, wrote The Biology of Animal Parasites. In that book, on page 516, we find this statement: natural selection can only act on those biological properties that already exist. It cannot create properties in order to meet adaptational needs. Professor of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology, Franklin M. Harold, stated, "Selection is for the here and now. It has no foresight and cannot anticipate what functions may be useful in the future." In other words, natural selection cannot determine if a life form needs an eye to see with, or an ear to hear with, a nose to smell with, a mouth to eat with, etc. Lise Bettner, PhD of physics at MIT, stated, "But in all of the reading I've done in the life sciences literature, I've never found a mutation that added information. All point mutations that have been studied on the molecular level turn out to reduce the genetic information and not increase it." Ray Boland, PhD in molecular and cell biology, stated, "The theory of gene duplication in its present form is unable to account for the origin of new genetic information, which is a must for any theory of evolutionary mechanism." Werner Gitt, the director at the German Federal Institute of Physics and Technology, stated, "There is no known law of nature, no known process, and no known sequence of events which can cause information to originate by itself in matter." Once again, I'd like to make this statement. If the evolution of humans from an ape-like ancestor is true, there should be two proof evidences. One is the fossil record. We have seen that the theory of evolution has no fossil record to support itself. The second proof evidence is a mechanism for change. We have read the statements of various experts that such a mechanism does not exist. Natural selection can only select. It only works on existing information and cannot create or add new information. We have also seen that genetic variation within a species is not evolution. So perhaps you're saying to yourself that you've believed in evolution for a long time, but now you realize it's a hoax. And you ask yourself, where does that leave me? Well, my friend, it leaves you at the beginning of the pathway to truth. It leaves you with the only other plausible reason for our existence. It leaves you facing the fact that there is a God in heaven, a God who has created this earth, everything in it, and the whole universe around it. A God who loves you no matter what you may have believed in the past. A God who is willing to forgive you for anything and everything that you may have done or said, in order to make a way for you to spend all eternity with Him. Yes, friend, the peace and happiness that your heart longs for can be found in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who has come to this earth giving His life for your sins and for mine. By way of asking you a couple of questions, I'd like to share with you a little more about the great love and awesome power of Jesus. If you have an evolutionary outlook on life, ask yourself the questions of why and where. Why did man evolve, and where is he headed? Basically, the evolutionary answer is that you're here by accident or by chance, and after you die, you become fertilizer for the soil. That is, up until the time we began making fancy caskets to lay our bodies in, at which point, your body doesn't even serve the purpose of fertilizing the ground anymore. On the other hand, when you look at life through the teaching of the Bible, you see a completely different picture. You see a loving God who created you to be by His side throughout all eternity. Unfortunately, because we have committed sins in our life, the blessing of being with God throughout all eternity could only come true through the sacrifice which Jesus had made by dying on the cross nearly 2,000 years ago on behalf of our sins. It's only through the perfect sacrifice of God Himself that man's sins can be forgiven. Oh, sure, we can forgive others when they harm us or do wrong to us. But when we do something wrong to someone else, we not only need to seek their forgiveness, but we also need to seek the forgiveness of God, who's created that person in His own image. The good news is this. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9, "If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." unrighteousness is wrongdoing, and being forgiven from all of your wrongdoing has got to be the greatest news that you've heard in a long time. Many people today go around in life with a terrible burden on their back. It's a burden of guilt that bears down on them and can cause them to bring ill health upon themselves. This is where God's gift of forgiveness steps in. When He forgives us, we no longer need to carry that burden of guilt around, which saps our strength and vital energies. Think about it. Jesus, the Son of God, died that you might live. In the Gospel of John, chapter 3, and verse 16, we find, "For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." What an awesome sacrifice He made for your life and mine. He came to this earth, suffered, and died the death that we deserve, that we might go to heaven and receive the life which He deserves. You may not be aware of this, but Jesus didn't stay in the grave. And that's a good thing, because it's awfully hard to follow a God that's dead. 1 Corinthians 15:6 says that more than 500 people saw Jesus after He was resurrected from the dead. That's right. Jesus was only dead in the grave for 3 days. Then He came back to life as the Bible predicted He would. And today, He lives in heaven. He guides us and watches over us. And at the same time, He's preparing a place for us in His kingdom. Jesus said in the book of John, chapter 14, verses 2 and 3, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Friend, don't you want Jesus to guide you through life? Will you accept the peace, happiness, and forgiveness that's found in accepting Him? If so, He's willing to hear from you even now. Simply talk to Jesus as you would talk to a friend. Tell Him that you accept His sacrifice on behalf of your sins. Ask Him to forgive you. Ask Him to show you how to receive all the wonderful things I've mentioned here by believing on Him and following His plan for your life. I encourage you to learn more about Jesus and turn your thinking towards a heavenly Creator, one who wants the best of everything for you throughout all eternity. In the New International Version of the Bible, the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29 and verse 11, God says, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." If you don't have a Bible, please pick one up for yourself at the local bookstore. I would recommend getting the New King James Version. Open it and begin reading the section called the New Testament. Allow God to speak to your heart as you read it, and ask Him to give you knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. In fact, I'd like to give you a challenge, and here it is. If you make a committed decision to give Jesus a try, you'll see a major difference in the quality and purpose of your life. You'll learn things that you never knew before, you'll understand things that you've never understood before, you'll be wiser and healthier than you've ever been. So you ask, what do you have to do in order to receive all these blessings? Friend, simply follow Jesus and follow His teachings. And in order for you to know what they are, I'm asking you to read a few chapters in the Bible every day. As you do, put into practice the things which you learn and ask God to work out His will in your life. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 12 says, "To all who received Him, to those who believed in His name, He gave the right to become the children of God." May God bless you and your loved ones.